what they would do is the equivalent to making a YouTube video claiming that another country's borders weren't real and that those people had no actual culture, right? That's kind of how this fascist imperialist expansionist mindset would have worked if we bring that up to today.
Okay, so fast forward now, it's like the 1900s. The communist leaders were small still at this point. And they used this century of humiliation and division, as well as this general lesson of unity equals prosperity, to rally the people for a new cause. Like, we've been sliced up and divided by all of these foreign powers. And when we're divided, we fail. So these communist leaders went off and created this grand vision of a united China, a story that China had actually always been united.
Zero Chinese people in the world have ever thought that China was always united. No one has ever said that in the history of Earth, ever. That is ridiculous. I mean, Chinese people have video games about the old kingdoms fighting each other. The West has video games about that. I mean, it's in their history, their lore, books, music. Every single thing to the core of their culture, they understand very deeply that China has lived through thousands of years of internal conflict and strife. To say what you just said is so obviously false. It's like flat earth shit. I mean, what the fuck are you talking about, dude?
They framed it in terms of this former glory of what China used to be, what it was before the outsiders came in, a grandiose vision of the past.
So I think this is the biggest map that he ever shows. And even this one isn't the maximum size that the Qing Dynasty was. Again, their culture doesn't exist. Their history doesn't exist. They're barely people is what he's telling you. It's all kind of secretive. It sounds like he's telling you something else. But when you take all of his conclusions and you line them up, you go, okay, Chinese people have no history. Their culture is bullshit. They have no borders. Yada, 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 yada. Oh, okay. Well, they're pretty much just nothing. Why don't we just go over there and the one thing he doesn't really say leaves that one up to you.
That never really existed. I mean, again, this sounds pretty darn familiar.
We will make America strong again.
No, you're making a point that doesn't exist. No one's trying to take them to another time in which they were more united, if there even is such a time. And the thing to note about this video so far is that all these points he's saying, all these things that he's claiming that the communists want to do, he's showing these clips here and there, and none of the clips, not one of them, has actually said anything that builds his case. He just makes that into something else that doesn't make any sense and gives you no evidence of it.
And that became the grand plan of the communist revolution in China, to make China united again, despite the fact that China had never really been fully united.
This is totally wrong, and this tells me again that you have no idea what the hell you're talking about. The communists back in 1921 didn't come along and say, hey, guess what we have to offer everybody? I know you're all not united, but what we have to offer is unity. The problem that you're not really understanding is when the communists came around, it wasn't the time of the Qing Dynasty. That was over, and the country was a republic. And at that time, there was a different Republic of China than the one that exists today. But all of the various versions of the Republic of China had all pushed for unity. So if you lived back then, you wouldn't hear one side saying, we don't need unity, and the other side saying, we're communists and we want unity. That doesn't even make any sense. Everyone was saying they wanted unity. Everyone. So the communists saying unity has nothing, that wasn't a unique feature of the communists. Unity was not a hallmark of what they wanted. That's what they achieved. The Republic of China wanted that, or said they wanted it, and never was able to achieve it. The communists were able to achieve it, but them saying that they wanted it was not unique.
This vision was a potent rallying cry. China would never be cut up again, never humiliated.
Yeah, so now you're actually talking about a difference between the communists and the Republic of China's KMT. Back then, the sentiment of the Chinese people was they were sick of all of the foreigners intruding on China. The KMT partnered with foreign countries, took massive loans, and became deeper and deeper involved with foreign countries. Meanwhile, the communists said, we don't need those other foreign countries. We're going to do it ourselves. That's not about unity. That's about self-reliance. Okay? So the big difference that you correctly point out is that the communists said we can do it without these other countries, whereas the Kuomintang, sometimes they said that, sometimes they said they needed the other countries, they kind of flip-flop, but the actual practice is that they just got deeper and deeper in bed with these other countries. And the people in China, because of many reasons, but that's one big reason, they therefore started to side with the communists more and more because they didn't want to become a country that was partially European.
China would never be cut up again, never humiliated. They would have defined borders.
So this again, I can't tell if he's just lying or if he just doesn't understand history, but defined borders, again, had nothing to do with the communists. This is something that came around as the modern notion of the nation state was evolving and all these things happened. All this stuff actually happened before the People's Republic of China. When the People's Republic of China was declared in 1949, the borders of China had more or less already been solidified. The modern concept of borders, exactly how we understand them today, had pretty much already been defined. And that included the South China Sea and Taiwan and all that stuff. Even in the Qing Dynasty, towards the late end of it, as the industrialization was spreading around the world, this is kind of when borders started to take shape in the way that we know them now. So even in the late Qing, we had a more solid sense of the borders, and that was, you know, 50 plus years before the communists took power. So you're way off on this one.
Ethnic purity.
In this video, he brings up ethnic purity and race and ethnicity quite a lot. It's very weird because when you look at the things that communists actually talked about and the many thousands and thousands of publications and speeches and news reports and interviews that they gave, Mao and many of the communist leaders went out of their way to specifically advocate for things like what we would call affirmative action today, this type of thing of giving advantages to minorities. You know who did have that concept quite a lot is the Xinhai Rebellion, the 1911 revolution, the revolution that led to the Republic of China way before the communists. That revolution, there was a lot of people who wanted to restore a Han leadership. And yes, this concept of the Han Chinese sort of deserving their reign of China, this has existed throughout China's history, and it still does exist today. There's a lot of people who think of things in this way. They're racialized at most charitable, you could say racist even, depending on what their specific views are. And I disagree with that. This has really nothing to do with communists. It just sounds like you don't like the Republic of China. That's really who you're talking about here.
Cultural assimilation.
Yeah, this part's true. They believe in multiculturalism, which is also assimilation. They go hand in hand. And in China and India, places like this that have something in common that I'm not sure if you are aware of, but they have regions inside of them that are so different from each other that assimilation is actually kind of necessary to have a country. You can't just let everyone speak their own language and everyone have their own cultures and their own tribes and their own traditions and never be able to communicate, or it just start to dissolve your country and break things apart and chaos ensues. Assimilation in these types of countries, it makes perfect sense.
And so for the last 70 years, that's the great project that China and the Communist Party have been undertaking, creating their own great empire controlled by a central authority.
So this is another far-right talking point where they just rebuild something that's normal into something that's scary, right? So now China's building an empire with this central control. You're like, no, that's just a country. What are you talking about? Every country is an empire in the way that you're describing it, where it's a bunch of different cultures and regions together with one government. That's just called a country, dude. America's not an empire because it has Hawaii, right? It's just not how this works. You can look back in history and you can describe things in a certain way and whatever, but America's not building an empire because Texas is part of it. That just isn't reality, dude. And this is how they demonize the entire structure of China so that even it itself is illegitimate. That's why we can commit acts of violence. And to prove further how not like an actual empire that China really is in reality, this is a list of every country that China has invaded and taken over since I was born. I hope you can write it down and remember this list. And this is a list of every country that China has overthrown the government of. If you want either of these lists, please email me and I will be happy to send it to you.
This project has coincided with China getting rich, pulling 100 million people out of poverty, and becoming a global superpower, all just in a few decades.
All right, so here's where we're kind of crossing into, is he a crypto fascist to, I think he just is one. I don't know for sure, but it's seeming more and more like yes, because 100 million people, what 100 million people? What are you talking about? That number is nothing compared to the actual number. And it's a number that you could literally just type into any search engine and get immediately, which means he had to have seen this and then tried desperately to find some source that has done these weird acrobatic feats of logic to try to reduce that number as much as possible. And then he just throws that number in his video as if that's the thing. And that's how he represents the good that China has done in the worst light possible. Now, you may be wondering, why is it that little betas do this type of thing? When I look at America, I'm extremely charitable. America is a very vital country. I think there's a lot of good that comes from America. But why do these little betas treat China in this way? I think psychologically, it's a little bit different than you think. I think it's actually more about they want to feel better about the fascism that they're pushing out to the world, the forced inequality. They want to have a good justification in their mind towards why it's okay to murder Asians or to go to war with these countries because they're different. When you're a beta, it's very hard for you to do that because you empathize with your simplified version of the reality that you live in, because anything advanced is too scary for you because your mind can't handle it. So you only can attack those things which are bad. So any good that you find, you have to reduce it. And this is a very common strategy you see online. Anyway, it's just interesting to think about these little betas and how their pathetic little minds work when they have to attack a country and reduce it. And this is also a really good way to determine if you're actually learning about China or if you're watching a propagandist who is just a beta cuck who's against China. And the way you can tell is they always reduce the good that China does as much as they can. Now we're talking about race. Again, what does this have to do with borders?